This morning we had a very, I would say, interactive and rich discussion. We had an overview of this nexus of humanitarian environmental agenda, just to help our thoughts in showing, reflecting that these two agendas are indeed interlinked and interrelated. By having a common agenda that is 2030 agenda and the SDGs, so we are not sort of contributing to two separate humanitarian and environmental agenda. They are all part of the same parcel and agenda. So that was very well presented by the mapping of the various actors, resources, and also partnerships in this very field. So that was very well presented. We also acknowledge the complexity of interaction between these two sectors. That it is not often easy to split and separate and address all of the issues at once. So we have to be aware of the complexity. There were also good examples of the very successful initiatives relating to this nexus that were also presented, and there were also other discussions about what can be done in the future and what are the areas that we need to focus on in the future. So an overview of all these deliberations will be presented later on by our moderator, Boy Brown, and I will not expand on that at this moment. I would like us now at this policy level, whatever we discussed this morning was addressing the issues at a very practical and technical level, hands-on issues, and what do we think at the mid-management level, perhaps, in addressing these issues when it comes to management of environment, in addressing environment in the management of the operations. Here, we would like to receive some guidance, some perspectives of how do we deal with this issue at a higher level, at a policy level, when it comes to the decisions of our governing bodies, to the funding issues, mandates that we have, and how much these varying mandates and nature of our operations would help us or actually avoid us to talk to each other, and what are the impediments, and as well as what are the areas for further work that would help EMG actually to define a set of terms of reference for one of its issue management groups in the future that will focus on this topic. So that would be the focus of this afternoon, and that our actually moderator of the discussion, moderator of the discussion in the afternoon, Akin will elaborate on that. I would like to take the opportunity also to specifically thank the government of Switzerland for supporting this Nexus series here. I'm very thankful to Felix, who has made it possible to participate today. It is very important to have the perspective of a country which has been a manifest of support to the humanitarian agenda, to the environmental agenda, which is also hosting a number of UN organizations here in Geneva and Switzerland. So thank you very much, Felix. With these opening points, I might have many other things to say, but the time is short and the agenda is very rich. I would like just to pass over the floor to Felix to say a few welcoming and opening remarks. And then after that, we would hand over to our moderator to take us on to the rest of the agenda this afternoon. So thank you very much, Felix.
Good, thank you very much. And excellencies, colleagues, thank you also for the opportunity to be here this afternoon. And thank you for the introduction, what has been discussed this morning. I think we all know International Geneva unites a range of organizations, United Nations organizations, and other stakeholders in the field of environment and humanitarian aid, and it's great to have this all together to discuss those important topics of the Nexus. And Switzerland, we fully support the important role of the EMG in this work to bring actors together to elaborate system-wide strategies for the environment. And I'm happy to give a few thoughts from a country perspective was important nexus of humanitarian aid and environment. When I was thinking about today, I also made my experience with humanitarian aid. And I worked before for NGOs, mostly developing activities. And then once there was a big drought and we also started doing some humanitarian aid. In particular, it was in Southeast Kenya. And as we're not those biggest experts in humanitarian aid, we really tried to go according to the rule book. So we did expertise, what do we need, talking with our partners on the ground, we did the conflict analysis, we had the faith-based organization, so we had looked at the religious, cultural impacts, looked at the gender impacts, and our backbone didn't care all about all of this. We just want to know about technical details of the water tanks. And he stressed so much about it, I even dreamed about those water tanks that day. And that was quite an intense experience. And after this was finished, our partners, they challenged us and said, okay, that was great that you supported us in this crisis, but what next? Do we just wait for the next crisis? What do we do now? And they challenged us that we should now get more involved in these kind of resilience projects to have also a bit of longer term impact. And I think also that's something that's important for Switzerland. We all know that humanitarian needs are increasing due to climate change, growing frequency and severity of disasters and protracted crisis. And to be able to reduce those growing needs, more investments are needed from governments, the UN, all other stakeholders, global funds, private sector, civil society, to work on disaster resilience and prevention measures. And Switzerland will try to also work on that. Over the next 4 years, Switzerland will allocate 1/6 of its international humanitarian aid budget, disaster resilience and preventive measures. That is one of the actions we are trying to take to also reduce those costs. And we also have seen that we, as we are an alpine country, Switzerland, so we're also exposed to many hazards. And it took us decades and many setbacks that we managed to have this kind of level we have now to work on disaster risk management. And it was a series of disasters we had that led to a fundamental mind shift in Switzerland about disaster. We went from pure protection against natural hazards to more integrated risk management approach. I think also that's something that's also coming on a global level. The challenge for today requires a holistic commitment to disaster risk reduction. So in 1997, Switzerland has established a national platform on national hazards, and this platform brought the shift to integrated risk management. We were able to include all relevant sectors, and this had many positive effects. One of them, that national hazard maps and risk informations are now integrated parts of land use plans and policies. Switzerland also tried to share this knowledge, so we also use this in platform cooperation, that we provide this kind of knowledge, how we build up those platforms. And if you try to translate this to an international level, it also shows us that we need all kind of actors bringing their expertise in. So in my case, the backbone only stressed about technical issues. It was a painful experience, but it was very useful because really we had to work on that, and he brought this in. So I think for us it's also important all actors bring in their own expertise, and we don't try to elaborate or enlarge their mandates, but we can create this kind of platform where people can work together. That's the most important. That we can be open to work together and find this, how can we share the knowledge, that every actor can bring in this knowledge what they have, that we can be preventive, work on that, and then if the stress moment comes, it also works out. To collaborate, we all know the common challenge. It is for the UN system one, it is for each government. Out of the silo, it's easy said and sometimes hard to be done. And that's also why I'm grateful for this initiative to this afternoon, we can discuss how this can be done. And thank you very much again for inviting us, for organizing this event.
Would you like me to go straight on? Okay, perfect. So let me just introduce myself quickly. I'm Ollie Brown. I was moderating this morning's session. I work in Kenya with UN Environment. We had an amazing discussion. I'm personally speaking, really fascinating. Lots of experience, lots of contributions from all over, and it was, I think we really covered a lot of ground, which I'm not going to do justice to in 5 minutes, but let me just try. The first area we were looking at is what are some of the challenges, as Felix was just saying, between joining these two areas that are historically hardened silos, the humanitarian silo, the environment silo, how do we cross over those? And there was a sort of appreciation that these are very complex dynamic situations that are fast moving. There's a whole series of you know unintended consequences that can happen as a result of actions in that humanitarian space, and that that you know these can have very long impacts. Again, some of the sort of really memorable statistics that came out was the average life of a refugee camp is 26 years, whereas you know it's created often in a real rush with a very short term view, but ends up having a very long term lifespan. So, I mean, the challenges that came out in terms of addressing these issues were the fact that, you know, we do have lots of tools, but the situation is very complex. We don't share a common language between the environment sector, between the humanitarian sector. There's issues of leadership, there's a lack of monitoring, there tends to be a lack of learning, and that's sort of associated with, you know, a lack of accountability and I guess a sort of an approach that doesn't prioritize longer-term thinking. And part of that is also kind of tied in by the different perspectives that people have and the different language that people use to understand what they mean by environment versus water versus waste and so on. But at the same time, there's an awful lot of good practices to call on. And actually, what really struck home to me was that a lot of this is actually very recent. There's a lot of stuff going on right now that's really, really interesting. Just in terms of new networks, there's examples of projects. We have somebody from the Moving Energy Initiative here. We were talking about the flexible, the Flash Environmental Assessment Tool, the SAFE Initiative, networks like the Environment and Humanitarian Network. There's a whole series of examples that we can call on in terms of how this has been done elsewhere, particularly the approaches to mainstream gender within UN operations and so on. And then, I guess, within that broader framework, the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals provide that framework in which we have an appreciation that environment underpins everything that we're doing in that sort of short-term humanitarian space and then also in the longer-term space as well. And there were some really interesting examples talked about in terms of mapping who the stakeholders are, looking at data, what data is available. And again, there's lots of pockets of excellence, but maybe the challenge is to bring that together and help people understand what there is out there. There's some really interesting examples, again, of making the case for why bringing the environment into humanitarian action isn't just a nice-to-do thing, but it's a need-to-do thing in terms of saving money, in terms of having better outcomes for the people that we're supposed to be serving. So there was an example of some work that's been done looking at provision of LPG fuel in refugee camps and how that actually had a very quick return on investment in terms of deforestation, yes, but also in terms of the way that people were actually using that and the appreciation that the recipients had for the different fuel sources and so on. So there's a lot to call on. And I guess the question is now, and this is where it comes to you guys, is what do we do about it now? And there are a few ideas, but this is where really I think the sort of leadership comes in as well. There was ideas around how do we kind of continue to make this case? How do we advocate? How do we get joint advocacy around trying to make this case for bringing together these two spheres? And to do that, how do we build on the evidence that we have, and how do we make that even more compelling? In terms of what we can actually do, how can we make it easier, change the incentives for having more joint deployments, more joint approaches, and so on? Part of that's about funding. Partly it's about linking technical expertise and putting that in place. Again, there were some really interesting examples around IFRC was talking about an example of just happening right now where they have a community resilience advisor in Cox's Bazar and addressing some of the resilience and the environmental impacts of the Rohingya crisis at the moment. I think there were a couple of sort of really interesting intellectual ideas that I took from it. One is this idea that the environment can be a bridge between sort of short-term thinking and longer-term thinking, and also between that humanitarian response and between the longer-term developmental approach. So the other thing I thought was really interesting was this idea that we need to be much better about how we prepare and think about some of the environmental consequences of humanitarian action. We talk about soldiers doing a lot of war gaming and thinking through scenarios of what might happen in a particular situation. Should the humanitarian community be doing a lot more humanitarian gaming, if you will, that helps to think through some of the unlikely or the potential consequences of what decisions they make? There was also some points around how can we be innovative? How can we encourage really major change in this. I think this is, again, this is one of those sectors that can tend to be quite conservative, and that there's a whole series of approaches that have been tried, they're tested. You don't have much time to innovate and to try something new unless humanitarian imperative right there. But how can the leadership help to encourage that sort of innovative thinking and really change, again, from this old paradigm from being a donor, perhaps to thinking more about the donors as investors, investors in resilience, investors in moving away from a cyclical humanitarian crisis, and moving away from this idea of recipients being passive recipients of humanitarian aid, to thinking about them as entrepreneurs, agents in their own future. So, very fascinating discussions. Thank you to everybody for all your contributions, and let me turn it back to Ahu.
Thank you very much. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot of elements from the morning session on our plate. And I do need to say perhaps you needed someone from the peace mediation and peace building community to be your moderator. I'm Achim Wedemann, I'm from the Geneva Peace Building Platform, which is a network of actors involved in peace negotiations and green light. I need a green light to speak. Thank you very much. Now I have a green light. Excellent. So the Geneva Peace Building Platform is a network of actors involved in peace negotiations and peace building processes, mainly based in Geneva, but also active in many places around the world. And before we get to our panelists, or the distinguished speakers, I would like to explore first a little bit something about you, about the audience. And I would like to explore with you three questions, which are, who of you really has experience in working across environmental and humanitarian sectors? Which is, how much of what we have just heard is really already part of your daily lives? For those who do have that experience, please raise your hand. Okay, so let's say a good third. So, which is already for the senior leadership, the first challenge of getting, when we have a meeting like this in a year from now, get up these hands to about 80%. The second question is about whether you would like to work more across the humanitarian and environmental sectors. So this is more about your wishes and your thoughts about the desirability of reaching out across to the other sector. So those who would like to do that, please raise your hands. So, ladies and gentlemen, panelists, you have your market of individuals within this field who would like to, in fact, intensify that work a lot more. And then finally, let's make a little game. To explore of how many of you could think of at least one way in which the sustainable development goals are linked to your work. For those who can think about at least one way, you can raise your hands now. Okay, of course you're invited. So how many hands go up if we think about at least two ways in which the SDGs are linked to your work? Okay, we're still pretty much at 100%. And if we take this to three ways, a few less. We could go on and go on and go on. But this question is to say about the multiple interactions that environmental and humanitarian work are connected to the implementation of the Sustainable Development Agenda. That is, of course, an underlying global agenda that is connected to reaching across sectors and institutions in the environmental and the humanitarian space. Now we know much more about you and the market of actors interested to reaching us across across the institutions and sectors. And now I think it is time that we know a little bit more about our panelists. And I'll take a brief introductory round. We have to my left Clarissa Askun, who is Chief of Staff at the International Organization of Migration. Welcome. Right next to Clarissa is Hugo Slim, who's head of policy at the International Committee of the Red Cross. Hugo, welcome. Thank you for being with us. And we have to the extreme left, Dr. Weijian San, who is Assistant Secretary General at the World Meteorological Organization. Welcome, sir. Then we turn to Mark. I'm glad that we have with us Mr. Elliot Harris, who's the Assistant Commissioner, welcome. We have then just one step further, Mr. Dagan Chafagain, who is Under Secretary General for Programs and Operations at the International Society. And then to the extreme right, we have Mr. Jasper Lund, who is Chief Emergency Services Branch and the Field Coordination Support Section at the United Nations Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs. And when I mean extreme right, I only mean your physical location, on the channel. So, ladies and gentlemen, I always like to set out a little bit what's coming. So let me briefly walk through to you the next 2 hours, which we have together here, in order to exactly get to these practical issues, these entry points for collaboration that our colleagues from the EMG can take note of in order to structure much greater silo busting activities between the humanitarian and environmental field. And we're going to kick off with a brief round to all panelists to a first question, which is exactly about this issue of how environmental factors are related to disaster and conflict risk. And again, to the practical entry points for collaboration between environmental and humanitarian actors. We then, after that first round, have a first interaction with some of you and how you would like to contribute to this discussion. But then again, keep a relatively open discussion with our panelists and also with you on 4 other questions that relate to a number of issues. And we then see where we go. 2 examples of positive change, the examples of integrating and humanitarian actions. 2 issues of aligning funding in order to make such integration work. 2 issues of bringing humanitarian and environmental actors closer together to foster collective outcomes. And I would of course say that just by focusing on the environmental and the humanitarian actors, you have only 2 sectors. There are, of course, in a field situation, many other sectors which need to be taken into consideration. Not less the peace-building angle, most closest to home for me, but also a number range of other issues from private sector and other constituencies. So I will keep, in particular those who know my moderation style, the discussion very active. I have also received not just the green light to speak, but also the green light to cut you off when you go above your allotted 4 minutes. I'm looking forward to our discussions. So let's get into the meat. So you have already heard there are some expectations on you to take and translate perhaps some of the more technical and practical issues discussed in the morning into the policy world, into what does it mean from a policy perspective, and how can you, from a more systemic level at the senior floors in your organization, to help to foster that interaction between the humanitarian world and the environmental world. And Clarissa, perhaps you can kick us off with a number of observations, particularly perhaps your views on the entry point for collaboration between environmental and humanitarian actors. How about that? You have a green light.
I'm happy to start off, but I'm sure that all my distinguished colleagues here will have a lot of areas and a lot of points to share. But I just think that coming from IOM and from our dealing in migration, I just want to say that and from the top management side, we are very supportive of all the efforts really in this field. And in fact, from IOM, we had identified migration, environment, and climate change as very, very important issues, and had started working on this already since the early 1990s. But it's taken all this time and I'm very happy to be here today, because it shows again that we all need to work together, and it's not enough just for each organization level to identify the issue, but we need to work together, and we need to work across agencies and collaboratively, and also across sectors.
said at this point. Google, why don't you elaborate your views on this entry point from your own personal experience and being in the humanitarian field for so long? But you, of course, have also been in the world, both with respect to peace mediation, where there has been a lot of interaction between sectors and institutions, but also now a long time in the ICRC. So how do you see the entry point?
Thank you, Achim, and thank you very much for inviting the ICRC here today, and especially to UNEP. We have actually a very long partnership with UNEP, and it's a pleasure to sort of be here today. How do we see it at the ICRC? I think it's very easy for us to see. I'm going through a phase of my life which I'm going to have to describe as the Nexus phase, because all I do these days is talk and write about Nexuses, or Nexi, whatever we should call them. And today we're doing the humanitarian environment Nexus, and then next week I get a rave and I have to talk on the triple Nexus, which is humanitarian development and peace. So we're in a Nexus phase. Now, that one can joke about that, but I think for the ICRC, the issue of environment has become blatantly obvious in policy terms and in operational terms. So in operational terms, it's very obvious to us whenever we work anywhere in the Sahel that we talk about double vulnerability, that people are exposed to a double vulnerability of climate and conflict. And those things often come together and really squeeze them in particular years, particular times. So if you're in a place like Somalia, you have conflict, but a lot of the people that are turning up in the IDP camps in Mogadishu today and who are moving are primarily moving because, in a sense, the climate and environment has been the final push to them. So we find it operationally on the ground, it's not difficult to make this nexus at all because people are being squeezed in that nexus between conflict and climate and environment in a number of ways. Now, the broader picture at policy level, you know, I put my hand up about the SDGs and things because it's also clear to us that these nexus policies, particularly the SDGs, humanitarian environment nexus, this connection that Clarissa just made, that was made this morning, about the respective footprints. You get a sort of environmental push that creates a humanitarian crisis, and you can get a humanitarian response that can push an environmental crisis. These are obvious policy connections to me, and everything that Elliot Harris said this morning about those interlinkages make total policy sense to the ICRC as well. So we're connecting, I think, at policy level and operationally very clearly on this, and it doesn't, you know, it's not a problem to us, it's a real issue that somehow we have to address. I just want to make one other point, which is inevitably about law, because I think IHL, International Humanitarian Law, saw this coming decades ago. It's in many ways, the prohibitions on certain forms of attack in the Geneva Conventions, attack against the environment, attacks against things like dams and chemical plants and things which can destroy the environment. It's very clear that Nexus is there in international humanitarian law as well. So I would ask you all, as we do in our work with UNEP, in a sense, to recognize international humanitarian law as environmental law in certain key aspects of its prohibitions and injunctions and its principles. So, I mean, I would say the connection to us operationally in policy terms and in legal terms, the nexus makes total sense.
So I think I'm gonna, and there's one element here, I think, which we can already highlight. There are a number of connectors, natural connectors, both at the practical and normative level, and the legal level that which you point out, which I think the EMG can take note of. And here, the first connector I would put at the for consideration is IHL as a connector between both environmental legal practice and the humanitarian legal practice. And again, another connector is the practical realities as they present themselves in the specific settings that do not necessarily adjust to silos, but that need integrated response. We go further, we go first to the left, and then we go to the extreme right and come back.
Okay, first, thanks for UNEP to take the leading role for coordinating that among the agents, especially the UN agencies. And we are very long partnership with UNEP, and maybe some of you that that's one of the most visible is that we jointly create IPCC in 1988. Now next year will be 30 years. Now IPCC report about climate change now it's a widely impact to all this, you know, even political and decision makers. So this is really it's a big task that we should working together at the UN agency, and because all the UN agencies have their clear mandate, but no one can cover everything. So that definitely need that global at United Nations level collaboration. Back to the topic, I would like to take a chance first that let you know that what are the global landscape about this environmental issues as well as the impact to the humanitarian activities. Now we, from very beginning, we said to the Switzerland, and it will be a very natural reference something from Switzerland. Some of you may know this. It's a global risk report, and there's a protection from this Davos Economic Forum, Global Forum. And if you have this careful reading of this report, and from the cover page, and you may find this very colorful pictures. What my explanation to you that this is this picture that from this top panel is called the likelihood, and the second panel is the impact. And this from year 2000 and then 2017, it's total 11 years. If you see the first 4 years, the different color representing the different areas, sectors. And the green part here is the environmental impact to the global economy. So if you see the first 4 years, it's no green color. However, start from 11, every year, the color box become more and more. And then by 2017, that's number one. And go to another page, at this one. And let's see that, because that's really it's global. The people from the economic perspective look at environmental issues. Here, this side is the impact. This side is the likelihood. Now, the corner here is the high likely and the highest impact. Now, this corner, the first is extreme weather. And the second one is a natural disaster. And the third one is a failure of climate change adaptation, which gives you a global picture that environmental issues have a global economic impact. And then this economic impact have a clear linkage to the humanitarian events. So this is the global picture that we have to pay great attention to the climate adaptation in the long run, and for daily, for the operational level, we have to handle the natural disasters, extreme events, to the impact of humanitarian its events. So that's what I would like to stop here in the first round, and I have more to say about it later. Thank you.
I'm sure you do. Thank you very much. And here again, allow me to emphasize perhaps important lesson. Could you just pass this to me? emphasize, of course, when looking at the risk forecast, and the WEF report is one of many different risk forecasts, one can very clearly see that these risks which are coming are too big for any one sector to handle on its own. And this is basically also, again, the rationale why one has to work across the sectors and with the sectors. And the other issue is that, of course, the threats are universal. We've seen so many natural disasters in the United States this summer. Fires in California and fires in Southern Europe. These are big environmental changes that require not necessarily a thinking of humanitarian and environmental nexus in classic war-affected and disaster-affected areas, but also in non-traditional areas, which is, I think, a new challenge, which is also linked up to the universal character of the Sustainable Development Goals, which are, of course, universal for all countries to adopt. So in this, we can look at the coordination of humanitarian affairs, and then see also how, of course, these challenges, which this global risk, this global risk picture illustrates so powerful, when we look at entry points across humanitarian and environmental communities, what would be a point of view from OCHA coming into this?
Thank you very much here from the extreme right, as I was being put. So first of all, I need to also do an apology because my colleagues have given me these sort of seven syllabus words that I hardly can express or know what they stand for. So let's be very pragmatic and switch my phone on silent. So let's start what we are good at in the humanitarian and development system. We are good at going out, like in the Rohingya crisis. People are coming, march in the area, we put in our camps, and we feed them, and we do humanitarian operations, and we are considering environment alphabetically, and sometimes environment is spelled with a Z. It's only if the mindset is there, the understanding, the knowledge, which we are often lacking, I have to say, and also if the means are available, and it's an agenda push made by the government that are hosting us while we do this. Now we have another thing which is called development. Development is bringing electricity, it's bringing connectivity, and everywhere in the world people can now sit and follow the development in other parts of the world. Everybody wants a Mercedes and everybody wants to take part in a reality show. And if you're sitting in the rural Kenya or Zimbabwe, you can't. So people are moving, we are seeing people shifting around more than we've ever done before. Where people are moving, they're moving to urban areas. What are the challenges that gives us? First of all, the biodynamic waste management is changing totally. So we are not recycling the waste that we were doing in the past in the farming communities, but they are becoming environmental challenges in themselves. But the other part is that we do no longer have a community that we can address. Both in the emergency setting, I was in Port-au-Prince during the earthquake, I came 24 hours because that's my work in the immediate phase. And to address the community is a major challenge in urban settings, because how do you reach out to them? What are the communities? They're interlinked, they're mixed in totally non-social fragmented manners. I was also 6 months in Somalia, in Mogadishu. And here you can't even do development or distribution aid, because as soon as you give any local inhabitant, an IDP, as Hugo was saying, any asset, they are a target because they have an asset and others want to take them. So there's a massive number of challenges that we have to address, which leads to poverty eradication, it leads to ensuring job and opportunities for development. It is also about ensuring governance and it's assuring security. And without these things being in place, it's very hard to start talking about environmental impact and how we overcome. So we can sit in this group here and discuss and reach to some consensus level, but we would need to reach out to other partners. We would need to involve cities, we would need to involve mayors, we would need to involve the political systems. We would not just come in, again, what we're good at, quick distribution of aid, but we would need to do sustainable development as a part of the humanitarian response to reestablish after emergency the water system, the drainage systems, the garbage collection systems, to ensure that regeneration, reestablishment, and more long-term environmental impact. And there, with the sustainable development goals, we need to ensure that they are coming down to the humanitarian operation from day one. So when we start something, what is going to end goal and what will be the impact of a sustainable goal in that operation? So that was the starting point.
Okay, what a starting point. And let me just pinpoint perhaps to the issue of the spatial dimension, the urban element. Because I think that is also from a peace and security perspective, the big new trend. In Geneva, there may be very soon the Geneva Cities Forum that will be established exactly to address this type of thing, to enhance the connectivity between international action and these kind of smaller meetings that face the biggest pressures, both on the environmental and the disaster front, but also with respect to humanitarian response. I understand the IFRC has also already worked for many years on this dimension, and so that the spatial dimension could also be a very important entry point to find really practical ways to work across the silos on the environment and humanitarian.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the invitation. I think it's worth the time I think investing on this afternoon's discussion, and I've already learned so much, so I hope that the next 1.5 hours I will be learning much more. Maybe the first thing when we talk about the collaboration is there has to be a convergence of mandates or the objectives of the goals. I think that's very, very important. And when I was looking at it, and when I looked at it, you know, the environment is so intrinsically linked to the health and well-being of the people. And we as Red Cross, that's our mandate. It's the health and well-being of the people. So I see that convergence there, is that what happens or doesn't happen on the environmental area will impact what we do or don't do as a humanitarian organization. So I see that convergence already. So we have a very good foundation, and I'm sure this is true for many other organizations that are present here. For the IFRC, the important element here is to focus on, I think you touched on this already before, is to have that balance of investing on resilience when disasters are not happening. I think a lot of times we want to have that response or the knee-jerk reaction, the big crisis happens, so we have to do something about it. In 6 months, the funding runs out, people pack the bag and leave, and they leave behind the crisis, sometimes bigger than they came in. So investing on the resilience building is extremely important when the crisis is not there. And for us, you know, when we have developed this resilience framework, and one of the key elements of that resilience framework at the community level is investing on managing the natural resources. How do you manage resources in your community? I'm really talking at the community level. And the second part is, of course, during the humanitarian response time, how do you make the humanitarian response greener? And I think, well, you mentioned that example of Cox's Bazaar. And I can tell you, and I know you are all very converted environmentalists, so I should be very careful of what I say here. There is a tension at times that there is a humanitarian parity. We have to move, and this still exists. So if I say that it doesn't exist, I will be lying. It still exists. But what we are trying to do is be better on that and avoid that trade-off between the speed that's required to respond versus, you know, ensuring that the environment is intact. And we want to be better at that. And that's one of the things we have done in this Kakshesh Bazaar, is to actually deploy an expert with the team already from the very beginning. So we don't have to do that right now. And I'm sure you heard that story. It is a very interesting story. The, you know, the trampling of some of the people on the move by elephant on the road. As if the people haven't suffered enough. You know, some of the people, you know, the elephants came on the road and actually trampled them and some very, very interesting. You know why that happened? Because the elephants were so upset that their road was being now crowded by people, and the places where they used to go and graze is being damaged. And they reacted. And unfortunately, some people got killed. It's very, very interesting story that came out of Kakshesh Bazaar, and that little bit also prompted us to take that action. Before I conclude, very important thing, and you brought the urban angle, and I would like to bring a bit of a rural angle. and I fully agree on the urban angle, and I hope I will have chance to share some of the examples of what we are trying to do across to address some of the issue. The rural angle is evolving. You know, a few years ago, sometimes we, of course, in our international community, we forget very quickly that Ebola happened a few years ago, and that was one of the biggest crises. Why did that happen? Ebola virus lives very peacefully with the bats. It's no problem. Peacefully, it has no problem. But what happened, the humans started encroaching in the habitats of the Ebola virus. So, now they cannot live peacefully with bats and other animals. What they do? They start migrating into humans. Of course, humans cannot. And for me, this is one of the worst examples of encroaching on the environment, what type of consequences it can have, a major, major health crisis in 2020. So that these are some of the issues which have taught us lessons that not investing properly on the environment will create humanitarian situations which will be costly, both in terms of lives, in terms of money, in terms of the long-term consequences. And the final point, sorry, I'll take a bit longer, is the connecting point. For us, the connecting point is at the local level. Of course, we need the global policies, we need the global we are not taking action on what the values are being conscious for that. I think the real impact, and if we really want to make a connection to SDGs and want to bring about that change, the connection will have to be better. We have to have a much better connection between what happens at the global level and what needs to happen, what actually is to take place at the local level. And for us, of course, the Red Cross membership organizations with the members and the grants and the volunteers, that's very, very key. I think that's what we can bring to the table on this discussion.
Thank you very much. One can, from a peace-building perspective, one could really echo exactly what you say, that dispute resolution and prevention starts from the local setting upward. And it is exactly what many peace-building actors are trying to emphasize by emphasizing the voice of that local context much more in the global discussion. Because that voice is very often not properly heard in discussions in New York and other policy capitals, which is very, very, very like just this small little voice. Everyone talks about it, but no one seems to listen. Of course, except Lina, who listens to it, because environmental change happens in very, very specific contexts, and perhaps you share your colleague's view on the entry point at the local level, and possibly have many, many other points which I see on your.
The points on the iPad are about the local levels. And you hadn't seen it before. So
I need to do that without much.
In fact, that was, to my mind, the most important point that came out of the discussion this morning, is that if we only start to think about the environmental consequences of humanitarian action, when that humanitarian action is taking place, it is already too late. We'll be treating it as an add-on, we'll be trying to sort of jerry fix it, something that could have been better organized. At the heart of the basis of any disaster risk reduction. Yeah. And I think perhaps one way of dealing with that is to say, well, let's examine the ways in which the environment can be affected by a humanitarian action, or let's examine the ways in which the environment can lead to the need for a humanitarian action. And in both cases, I think it becomes evident when we look at the transmission channels of the adverse impacts, it becomes evident who the policy makers have to interface with, whom the operational personnel have to interface with, how the local community can be brought into the equation. In many respects, particularly in developing country contexts, the environmental aspect is closely linked to the management of the natural resources. A couple of examples. If you take the kinds of disasters that occur when you hear in the news about mudslides that has killed 1,000 people, that is almost invariably linked to people having denuded a part of the landscape or deforested it, and having built settlements on areas where there is no natural retention of the water, and then at some point it builds up to the situation where the soil gives way. When you hear about people having to leave their homelands because they can no longer feed themselves on their property, there has been either encroachment on desertification or poor irrigation practices or soil degradation, which sometimes is led back to appropriate agricultural practices. In many of these areas, it is possible to reduce the risk of an environmental catastrophe that leads to displacement by changing the way in which you manage those resources. And that requires, I think, engaging in a conversation and perhaps even in a partnership with those who are using those natural resources to point out to them the consequences of inappropriate management of those resources. By the same token, that kind of discussion already prepares the humanitarian community. So in the case where people are displaced because they can no longer draw water from their wells, that we know how to manage the question of providing them with water. That we know that if there is a crisis building, encroaching, I'm not talking about an outbreak of a conflict or some natural disaster, but a crisis that develops, we know what to prepare for. You know, we know that we will have to be supplying water. How are we going to bring it in? Are we going to bring it in the plastic jugs that have to be disposed of afterwards? Or are we going to find some other way of managing? So it's more, to my mind, it's very simplistic, but awareness of the channels through which the environment interacts with the humanitarian and the humanitarian environment allows us to ask the right questions, to put the right people around the table, and to start anticipating the sorts of solutions that we might even prepare for. As again, I come back to that thought that if we are only thinking about how we take the environment into account as we are mobilizing for the emergency response, it's already too late. And if we have set up the refugee camp and have put in place the old diesel generators, it is going to be much more difficult to replace them. And these are the things that I think we have to anticipate in that community between the two sets of priorities. But again, I think one of the main issues is to realize that the environmental community will think about these things in a different way than the humanitarian community. Understanding that enables us to talk to each other in a way that allows us to draw on our respective expertise without any one set of priorities having to have or to hold sway over the other set.
It's fascinating how your emphasis on preparedness and also your emphasis on thinking about resilience when nothing really happens connects very powerfully also to the Secretary General's effort at the moment as he drafts his report on prevention. And I think there is a lot in from a joint voice from the humanitarian and the environmental community to also emphasize how this preparedness and investments in resilience contribute to United Nations agenda on prevention. Not less to say also in preparation to the high-level panel on sustaining peace in April. So these are all, it shows already where the boundaries between the humanitarian and the environmental dimensions are being expanded out to other dimensions and other broader policy issues that at the very moment are very high on the agenda in New York. Thank you for an excellent first round of comments and stipulations and thoughts. I would already now presume that many of you are very curious and you have questions or want to have a comment or want to dig a little bit deeper. So let's open up the floor for a few minutes to collect a few observations, and then we're going to come back to our panelists to continue the discussion. So anyone who felt stimulated, and don't say that you have not been stimulated because it couldn't be.
Sorry, let me just start off. I guess I'm going to be slightly bold, and I'm interested in this question about we have a range of different organisations here. And if I can be a bit impertinent, I'd be interested in your frank thoughts about how good your organisation is at taking on new ideas and new ways of doing things. And from UN Environment, I can say this is something that we struggle with. And what in your opinion are some of the barriers to doing that?
Okay, reflect a bit on that. We'll take a few more. I'm sure there's more to come from this side here. We have one question right here, the gentleman in the front.
Good afternoon. My name is Craig Sanders. I'm with UNHCR. I think to answer that last question, we'd have to invoke the Chatham House rule so it doesn't get back to the mothership if we actually spoke honestly, all of us probably. This is absolutely great food for thought from the various interventions, and I think a number of the points certainly struck me as being right on the mark from issues around preparedness. Is it too late already? The urbanizing environment, energy, and so forth. In my job at UNHCR, I'm actually overseeing and supervising a number of the technical support functions, including environment, including energy, public health, WASH, site planning, shelter, solutions, and so forth. My question, I think, for all of us would be, I can assure you these days, I will be in Bangladesh in about 3 days from now. I worked there for 3 years. I know that country well, and I know that that area extremely well, having worked on the Rohingya refugee issue there for a long time. I am following it very closely, I think, like all of us are, watching the unfolding of events in Cox's Bazar, one of the most densely populated countries in the world. This is one of the actual poorest regions in that country. extremely vulnerable to climate, to so forth, cyclones, very fragile environment, as you mentioned, the case of the elephants, having seen that before. I guess my question is really about the, are we all, as humanitarian agencies, are we able to rise to this challenge, to muster this? And I see from my own organization, but I see it from others, very often it is an add-on. Someone referred to environment as being an add-on. We are often in trying to provide life-saving assistance. And so this requires, to my mind, a ratcheting up, a bringing in of new partnerships. We need to have other actors in here, and this includes the private sector, it includes the development partners, of course our host governments that we work closely with, but I really sense watching this unfold in, watching these events unfold in a place that I know very, very well in Bangladesh, but also occupying my time with Uganda, West Nile operations in Uganda, where 1.3 million refugees in Uganda, and watching the devastating environmental impact there in a country that actually has huge resources. I guess that's my question to the panelists would be, what do we need? Who else do we need at the table? I see a lot of the usual suspects, if I may, but I don't think, if I really am honest, I'm not sure that the usual suspects are able to lift the way we need to lift to be able to really address these issues. So I'm partly answering that question there. It's not so much about new ideas, but it's really about recognizing our own limitations, and are we able together, and do we need to have others involved in this, and if so, how do we bring them in? That's a rather long-winded intervention, but that's what I'd like to see is, who else can we get in here, and how do we get them in here, and how do we lift this? Because it's not working right now.
Thank you very much. A lot of excellent comments, a lot of things to relate to. Let's take one more or two more, depending on how they are. We surely have already enough substance. But someone from this part of the room? Here in the front and then in the back. Yes.
Thank you very much. We enjoyed listening to the comments of the panelists.
Could you briefly introduce yourself?
Yeah, I am Javad Amin Mansour, PQR and Ambassador of Iran here in Geneva. Coming from a region which needs humanitarian action and also environmental, is suffering from environmental, maybe we can call it disasters, and in terms of causes and consequences, it's very important. That's why maybe my country has one of the strongest humanitarian mechanisms in order to meet the challenges. As we know, maybe we can say that the common point between humanitarian actions and environmental issues is disaster, which applies to both fields. Some of the disasters are due to human induced activities, and some of them like conflicts, like what we are doing in terms of environment management or mismanagement, whatever you call it. And some of them are due to geological reasons, which is completely natural and human beings is not involved. I think maybe we have to work at two levels of policy setting of law and also at the level of the field. My question is at the level of policy setting, question from panelists, distinguished panelists. We have Geneva Conventions and and we have a lot of environmental conventions, so-called multilateral environmental agreements. How can we bridge between these two sets of laws? Do we need to first approach humanitarian law in order to make it more environmental, or do we have to start from environmental law to do that? And at the field or action, do we think that the UN system and the existing existing specialized agencies are enough to cover the challenges and to meet the existing challenges, or do we have to do something new, or any innovation?
Thank you very much. So, a very important question on the applicability of different legal regimes on the humanitarian and the environmental side, and is the UN system up to the challenge? Also, an issue which you raised: how can we rise to the challenge, both as a UN system or the system connected to other capabilities within and outside the UN system? We had one more comment up there, and then we're going to continue the conversation with the panelists.
Yes, thank you very much. Mohamed Amatola from the UN Environment. It's been very interesting first round of interventions from the panelists. I would like to thank you for that. But I just put it that a lot of the organizations on the panel rely a lot on governments, host government or member states to actually carry out the work and implement the work. And I'd noted that the Swiss government was also an issue on the panel. I wonder how much do you rely on governments, and are you actually getting enough support from governments, and perhaps in terms of the delivery on the ground, what really are the challenges faced beyond operational and programmatic? Thank you.
Excellent. Which points the finger on the role of governments, both within the questions which were put out in one of the questions of funding support, but also with respect to very practical support of host governments in supporting the operations across the environmental and humanitarian space. Ladies and gentlemen, we have quite a palette of issues out here. We have something on your frankness, on understanding of what are the limits of your organization's learning, what are the opportunities of strengthening the learning across sectors. The issue of rising up to the challenge, to the risks which we have heard, the continued perception of different issues and topics being add-ons, and how we can get over that. What are the partnership mechanisms or the collective impact arrangements to work with the private sector, the development community, and other related constituencies in specific settings, and the issue of legal regimes. So many different things on your mind. Is there any first speaker that has first hand up? You go.
You're the last.
I feel challenged by my colleague Holly on some of the weaknesses. I'm going to say three words and try to explain why I think that those do constitute barriers. First is specialization. Second is governance. And third is funding. I'm going to be nasty on the funding part. Specialization is our strength. System. Under that UN umbrella, we have specialization, world-class expertise in each area, but specialists have difficulty talking to other specialists. We understand inherently our area of speciality, but we find it difficult to translate the other speciality into our own terms. That can be done by greater contact. I always say in New York, we don't want to destroy the silos. That would be ridiculous. I'm sorry to be so blunt. It is the very specialization that makes us what we are. What we need is to learn how to talk to each other a little bit better. Opening silos, not breaking them down. And governance is, in many respects, a part of that specific problem, because we are governed, in many respects, via the UN system, by those ministries that are responsible for our area of specialization. So I don't think that anybody who sits in our Committee of Permanent Representatives comes from the Ministry of Education. And yet education is critical to any effort to protect and conserve the environment. So here we have part of the problem. Our governance structures foster and deepen that specialization, which makes it difficult for us to interact. But when we come to the funding, I think that's where the rubber actually does hit the road.
And the funding for humanitarian action emergency relief comes from entirely different sources than the funding for environmental protection or the funding for development. It obeys entirely different political imperatives, and it is unrealistic to expect that humanitarian assistance should behave in the way that longer-term development assistance should behave. It's not reasonable to expect that. For one thing, it's a different source of money from a different pot. And as long as we have that fundamental inconsistency and yet insist on demanding that humanitarian assistance take a longer-term development into account, or that environmental development should be looking at the funding for humanitarian relief, well, we'll run up against a closed door, because it just doesn't make any kind of sense to those who make the decision about the funding. So we need to find a way to bring into the funding decisions on the longer-term development trajectory an awareness of how we will need to deal with the short-term, particularly in a disaster relief context or a humanitarian context. Not to say that longer-term development funding has to become humanitarian assistance, it has to be taken into account. I'd like to suggest, in response to the ambassador's question on whether we are fit for purpose, if we have the right agency, I think we probably do if we can learn to work together better. And again, it comes back in many respects to the way we're led, but also to the way we're governed. If we are formulating policies that have to be approved by our governing bodies, we need to be sure that we're taking into account everything that we should be taking into account as we formulate our policies. And that might mean reaching out to other agencies to say, come and help us formulate the environmental impact of, let's say, the longer-term development policy or the environmental assessment that has to go into the humanitarian relief. We don't do enough of that, and our governing institutions don't demand that from us. I think if we move in that direction, we'll find that there is enough expertise in the system to go around to address all the questions, as long as that expertise gets properly deployed. And it's simply a question of being aware that in the system, the expertise resides, is to know where, and to be able to mobilize that expertise. And in that context, another nudge to the funding part. That kind of, if somebody were to come to me and say, do an environmental assessment of this conflict there, unless I have budgeted for that, I don't have the resources to go and do it. Yet if I try to put into the budget submission a contingency, in the case where I might be asked to go and do an environmental assessment, our government might be able to do that. So it's inconsistent.
Oh, I saw some nods and some frowns.
Thank you. I thought those were great questions, so I won't try and answer them all. Firstly, on Ollie's one, ICRC, I'm not worried about the mothership, actually, because although a lot of things are confidential at the ICRC, self-criticism is not confidential. Taking on new ideas, I think the ICRC takes on all ideas, and that's what's rather stressful about being in it, because it's desperate to see what's happening and make sure it relates it to armed conflict. So we take on loads of ideas. New ways of doing things, no, we're not so good at that. So we get stuck in patterns and habits and trenches of ways of working. But having said that, when we do take on new things, we have been, I think, very good at them. And one of those would be cities. I think if I look back over the last 10 to 15 years, we have said, no, the problem is not small water wells in rural Africa now. The problem is sustaining massive urban water waste, sanitation, energy infrastructure, and we have made that change. And the other change we've made, so that's strategic to environment. The other change we have made that's strategic to environment is that if you ask us now, a lot of you here are stereotyping humanitarian action as short-term urgent need. And that's true when we talk about, you know, an influx of refugees like from Rakhine into Cox's Bazaar, or if we talk about sudden infectious diseases thing. But actually, if you talk to the ICRC about armed conflict, we will say to you, humanitarian action is long. Okay? We know we are going to be in wars for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. So in fact, we are now thinking long as humanitarian action, much more than short. And that's why we've asked donors for multi-year financing and got it, and that's why we're planning that way. So I think we can't go on with this excuse, and we certainly don't want to go on with the excuse that, oh, well, the humanitarian imperative, humanitarian action is always very short term, so what can we do about the environment? That doesn't work anymore. We, you know, humanitarian action is long, and that's how we advocate and plan and integrate all these things into it. So that's a big one. On ideas, I just want to put this because it always sits on my conscience and our conscience about our footprint. We track our environmental footprint, our green footprint, and have been for a few years now. If we look at our 2014-15-16 footprint, there's one thing that is responsible for 50% of our carbon use in those years. And it completely distorts the rest of our really good work on our footprint. And those things are the aeroplanes in South Sudan. Because we have an airborne operation in South Sudan, and using these huge Aleutian jets, these amazing Russian jets to airdrop and a whole fleet of other aeroplanes. And that has accounted for 50% of our carbon footprint every year for the last three years. Now that is a problem. I would love to have a new idea about it, and we haven't quite cracked that yet. So that takes me to Craig's question, you know, who else should we include? I think we have to include the environmental movement much more. I think we have to have people who have spent the last 10, 20, 30 years laterally thinking a problem like that, or working much more about how we can do things differently. So in terms of what Elliot's saying about opening up silos, opening up the doors as well, as you're saying, to let, you know, new ideas of paradigm shifts in humanitarian action in, I think would be good to solve our plane problem, if you like. Cash does it a bit, but it doesn't do it in South Sudan, because there's no markets for people to buy anything in there. The ambassador's question is very important, I think. You know, how do we bridge all these laws? In the ICRC, what we would say is almost, and a very important thing to do about law is to put it into domestic law. So we spend a lot of time, as you know, trying to encourage states to domesticate and put into their national legislation international humanitarian law. Now, I think it would help us a lot if states, and particularly cities and municipalities, had very strong environmental laws that they said, look, you know, even though you're working here in an emergency, 5, 10, 15 years in many cases, you've got to try and respect these environmental laws. We want this emergency to be managed within the parameters. Inevitably, there'll be discretionary because it won't be ideal, but we have environmental laws. And I think that's very important. It should be the state, the government. You know, the Red Cross, Red Crescent have done a lot of work on natural disaster law, and I think those sort of frameworks must continue to apply. I'll leave it at that. On governments, Mohammed's question, I think on the whole, we find with our investors, and I call them investors, the high contracting parties to the Geneva Convention who support our work, we find that if we're doing something innovative and important and it makes sense in the interest of people affected by our conflict and wider international policy, that they'll support us. And very often when we're not doing that, they'll nudge us. So, you know, we are being nudged on the environment, and that's right.
Well, thank you for, if you can pass it on, but thank you for getting the issue of stereotyping there, what you said, that humanitarian community shouldn't allow itself to be stereotyped into that it's only about the short term. That, like ICRC, it's, you are thinking more and more longer term, and that has, that ripples through the entire system, how you go in terms of, for on your policy engagements, on your programmatic work, on your very thinking of how humanitarian actors think on the ground and do operations on the ground. So I think that's a very important take on, because these stereotypes are still very much alive in many hands, I think. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you. Let me first to assist channel your questions about new ideas. Just a little bit more about the WMO. We are composed of 191 members and mostly National Meteorological and Hydrological Service. That's more a science and technological organization, but also handle the operational business. We have no ideas about how to stop the war, but we do have new ideas on how to further contribute to this disaster risk reduction and to the humanitarian actions. And the first thing first, that we are working on more accurate information, because we would like inform the decisions of all the governments and including international organizations. And if, for majority for the audience, if you agree that current weather forecast accuracy to continue to improve, and that's give a great credit to WMO, because the evidence that the current 7-day weather forecast is equivalent to the 1-day forecasting 30 years ago. So we continue to improve due to our very effective collaboration. We actually date every second. And all the observations at the national level will exchange across border, across national boundary within 1 hour. That's why that all the global centers can run a global model, and then you can get a global weather forecast. We are working more accurate for extreme events, because most of the humanitarian events was due to the extreme environmental events. That's a trigger. So if we could further improve this capability, and then we can help a lot to the global and the national. So I also come back to this Red Cross colleagues that importance at the local level. And in WMO, we put the disaster risk reduction at the number one priority for more than half a century. We believe that's most important. Yes, you can say beautiful weather, enjoy it. Yes, that's a happy. But what about extreme bad weather? That is mostly needed at not only public, but also different government agencies. They would like have that information for their decision. So, but I just let you know that it's not all the countries can fully benefit from that information, because it's lack of mechanism, lack of that kind of, you know, joint actions. Because country by country have a different system and different, you know, mechanism. But I give you a good example that which the country I came from, it's China. In China, they have a meteorological law established in 1995. And in that law, they have a chapter 5 specifically address a disaster risk reduction, which define that all level of government must take actions based upon the authoritative voice from their national and the provincial meteorological service. If they do not take action, they will lose the job. So that's after that meteorological law take effect, and the death toll, a whole country, declined quickly. And then now it's come to this, you know, it's really, it's new historical record, but we are still struggling how to further reduce the economic loss, because the country become richer and more property, and especially along the coast and the huge big cities. And there are more, you know, disaster problem region, and a lot of things that you still need a lot of new efforts. So in this regard, I would like all the partners, UN organization, to help WMO, working together with WMO to promote the national legislation and make sure all this information produced at the national authority voice can be best used for decision, for take actions. I know some countries say, oh, we are a diplomatic system, we just issue the information, whatever, you believe or not, it's your responsibility to take actions. But after several events, they say, no, that's not work. They must really take action, whatever you understand or not, but this is the information, you must take action to evacuate the people, otherwise, you have a big death toll, even just one event. So that's a lesson we learned from the past. The second level, I also would like to see, beyond the national level, above, one level above, what about the larger environmental issues? And I will give you an example, which is just this morning, we have a workshop to promote global multi-hazard alert system. I have a presentation from UK Met Office. I'm lucky that I have a UK friend next to me. They show that
Brexit buddy.
They show a case that in 2015 and 2016, it's a refugee crisis. How UK Met Office take advantage of the global and the regional information and provide and a quite a large scale of information to make sure that all this responsible agency
can benefit from that and to minimize the death toll and the disaster. But definitely, that's a meteorological service is only play a role in that area to provide the information. For example, most of these refugees, they go through by sea. And they do not understand the danger with the waves, with the strong wind. But this information gives all the agency that clear information how to take action to avoid or to minimize this kind of disaster. So this is the information which I believe that we are still in the process. And including that, we have the publication for the atlas of mortality and economic loss from weather, climate, and water intrusions, 1970 to 2012, 42 years statistics. We use this publication to communicate all the governments, say you need to very seriously to take actions and benefit from your national meteorological hydrological service. Otherwise, your investment, but finally, you did not get great investment return. That's the your national effort. You should do your best to benefit from that. Thank you.
I think you are absolutely right in pointing the finger to the issue of information and information exchange. Because we live in a period where we have never had more information. And many of the best information is in some of your, as you said, indeed very specialized orientations of the UN system, fantastic analysis. And also at the with the ICRC and the Red Crescent Societies, very granular information. But it seems that that joint analysis to really translate this into action across the humanitarian environment is really an effort which should, on the one hand, be not very expensive, not very difficult to do, but which is really one of these opportunities, these entry points for working across humanitarian and environmental actors, both in the long-term risk planning, which you mentioned already before, but also in the more immediate situational planning in specific settings. What you, of course, IOM works in many places very much from the granular, localized understanding. So perhaps this is an element which you would like to connect to, but also considering some of the other questions.
Yeah, thank you. I'm just a bit overwhelmed with all the questions and all the responses, which are, of course, very, very, very valid. But I'm just thinking a little bit more on the day-to-day, or for example, the reality today, the huge Bangladesh emergency, where we are many agencies involved, and we all have a certain way of acting, and it's considered a humanitarian approach, and as my colleague from UNEP was saying, there's the humanitarian funding, etc. These are the realities. Of course, we all need to find new ways of working and new avenues and new donors or new sources of funding. Private sector is very important, as you were mentioning, trying to break out of these molds. But in the immediate, we still have the problem of the day-to-day, that the emergencies are there. We have to respond to the man-made emergencies, but also to climate. We just had huge disasters in the Caribbean. So here are things that are happening at the same time. And how do we, as agencies or as UN, how do we respond to these things in the immediate? And at the same time, as you were saying, how do we prepare? And all these are so important. And how do we break the barriers of the humanitarian model or the development model, which has been going on for so many years? So these are the challenges of today. You know, how do we do it? We have experiences, but again, what we're talking about today, I think, is more how to find collaborative platforms and how to break away from the models. This is where we are today.
The constant challenge to make sure that to manage the constant water dripping on the stone and the wave which is coming.
Shorter, you said Bangladesh, but Bangladesh we've been since it's been an ongoing crisis. Now it's a huge crisis, but it's not new from today, from this year. We've been there for many years taking care of the same population, the displaced population. So are they new? And humanitarian emergencies before used to happen and then sometimes end or move on. Now they all seem to just keep on continuing. From crisis to crisis, and looking to see how we address and how we prepare.
No, thank you. Maybe on your first question, so I will not answer it directly. But I think in IFRC, I think we are pretty good at getting new ideas and also generating new ideas. I think the way we are pretty informal type of organization with our membership, of course, the diverse membership. So we generate a lot of good ideas. But I think where our weakness is because we are so diverse, with 190 members of very different capacities and very different contexts, we are not good at prioritizing and picking a few good ideas and, you know, pushing it through. A bit opposite to my friend from ICSC. we generate a lot of good ideas, but prioritizing and follow through is much more difficult for us. You know, few very simple things we have recently done. If you come to our office, you will see, you know, we have worked with some private sector colleagues to develop a very simple hand washing tool. So it saves a lot of water by using that very simple thing, because water is very, very important in certain settings. But it also encourages people to go and hand wash. Obviously, our colleagues had did a bit of a research. What they found was, if there is a mirror, people are more inclined to go and wash hands. So very small things making a difference. You know, it motivates people to go look your face when you are washing your hands. Very simple thing. Slightly bigger research we are currently working also again involving the private sector has been, and I think, you know, Hugo and you also talked about the urban environment. You know, one of the big challenges of urban environment now is sanitation. You know, the rural disaster is easy. You go, you dig the hill, you dig the hole, and you create a toilet. You know, a lot easier. What do you do in our urban sector? You know, how do you create that? So we are currently working on toilets. We call it toilet that never fills. You know, using energy. So a lot of research is still to be done because we need to ensure the safety and everything. But you know, but we have done some good progress. So I can give many such examples. But then picking one or two up, because you know, getting new ideas implemented on 190 countries is a big initiative. That's what we need to be better at. And probably I will give maybe 4 out of 10 on that one, while you give 8 out of 10 on the generation of the ideas. Who should be on the table? I would probably say 2 more actors, maybe even 3. One is clearly, we need to get the development actors here. I think, as I said in my introduction, the development model has very direct consequences on environment, but also on humanitarian situation, the creation of humanitarian situation. So I think the development discussion. The second one I would say is the private sector. I think this is, I know a number of organizations have been partnering much more with the private sector now. I do believe on the innovation, creation of the new idea, but also the technical expertise that the private sector can provide could be extremely, extremely useful. And also, I think that there is now a momentum in the private sector areas. It's good for their business to be seen environment friendly. So I think the environment is right for us to bring them on the table. And maybe the third one I'd like to mention here very much is, you know, linking to my first point on getting at the local level, you know, civil society organizations, much more, because the local action will happen through them. I mean, we have branches, more than 160,000 branches around the world, but even we believe that engaging with many civil society organizations at the local level would be key. I think on the issues of the law, I think we talked a lot. For me, it's probably not either or. I think we probably need to have humanitarian laws, but also the environmental laws. And I think, as Hugo mentioned, and my colleague Tessa was very intimately involved, you know, we have been working around 100 countries now on the domestic disaster laws, trying to support the government initiatives. And one of the very interesting learning of that is, because when you start with the disaster law, you think, no, it's a law linked to disasters. But once you start getting deeper into it, it touches every part of the government. You know, once you want to put something, it touches this ministry, it touches the Ministry of Water Resources, it touches the Ministry of Planning, it touches the Ministry of Finance. Suddenly, developing what we call disaster law seems to be a much complex process, touching almost every branch of the government. But this is something I think we have made a lot of progress in the last 10 years or so. And you know, I was in Sierra Leone a few weeks ago after that landslide, and you described the situation there. I mean, clearly, if there was a simple building codes on how you allow buildings to be constructed or not, could have probably prevented some of that. And I don't know how many of you have been in Freetown. You know, you go there and look around. It's not a very pretty sight. Not only that hill, but many, many, many other hills, and the way the construction is taking place there. So I think and you come from Iran, and you know the Iranian Red Crescent is one of the very strong organizations working very closely with the government and have a very strong foundations on disastrous laws, also linked to the DR Act there. So these are my sort of input for now.
Good. Yes. Having his microphone always reminded me of when I was studying and supplementing my income by being a DJ. But are we creative and innovative in Orchard? Yes, we're all over the place. We are so all over the place that we create task force for innovation, and that's where I drop off, because then we are killing it by structures and priorities. Do we implement any of them? No. Why not? Because we are so risk averse. We don't want to fail. We do every year what we call a humanitarian network and partnership week here in Geneva. We bring all our networks and partners to come and discuss issues of common interest. And we went through two specific crises, the response, hurricane response in the Philippines and the Nepal earthquake response. And we went through all the organizations' report or lessons learned to identify common challenges. Did we find any? No. Because nobody pull out and say, sorry, we failed. Why? Because we know if the donors read, they say, okay, that's where we should not put our money, let's give it elsewhere. So we have, as a society, a big challenge in daring to admit that we are failing and learning from this failure. So without that, we cannot be really creative and innovative. I'm very jealous on IFRC with your partnership with the private sector. I love to come to meetings with colleagues in IFRC. They can just say, should we have a meeting? I said, I'm coming. To go to IKEA, have Swedish meatballs and coffee, and do some shopping for my wife. So that's you know, and some way that I know it's a coincidence, but it is also creative. Now, when private sector coming to me and saying we want to engage, and that's the first question I have to them, I said before we have the coffee, or we have the coffee, I said the first question I have to do good or feel good. Most of them saying, it's for our staff to feel good, and they said fine, that's great. Continue with your corporate social responsibility program, but it's not for me, and have a nice day, and thanks for the coffee. So, if it's to do good, then the next question is, okay, the rule of engagement is the humanitarian principles. Because it's not shareholders, it's not your stocks, it is how you can integrate and work with us and almost to support us and complement us. And I think that's where we are growing. Where we are failing as a humanitarian community is that we do, and I have to criticize ourselves, we do pity work. We talk about latrines made of recycled capsules from bottles or whatever it is. What we need to do is to look at the business models. How can the private sector really complement us, not do an IKEA tent, which is ridiculous in itself, sorry, but it is really where can the private sector go in and do work that we can't do in a way that we can't achieve, with the way we organize the sector. That leads me to the next thing. Cox Bazaar, is that a challenge for us? It's something that we as a humanitarian community could do on Wednesday afternoon. Why are we struggling? We're struggling because we're engaged in crisis all over the world, in political crisis. The Syria, the Yemen, South Sudan are not humanitarian crises, they're political crises. And they should be addressed by the political system, and that system has failed to address these. And that's where we sometimes should go back to our political leaderships and saying the Security Council of the UN is set of pieces for you to address. We have carried on the humanitarian load from all these crises, and we've done it somehow also with pleasure, because it's been job opportunities. Just look at how the humanitarian sector has grown in the last 3 or 5 years, significantly, 4 doubles. So we're not going to say no, but sometimes we need to say no. So therefore, in the Cox Bazaar, we could do that, and there have to be also strict or very challenging house. Because what's the key challenge we have now is a dispute between you different agencies, whether it's IOM, UNHRS in the lead, and what stands in the middle, and how can you support and make this work. There should be a same also. We should go back and say, these are people in need, we need to assist them with whatever we can, and we don't care what t-shirt we are wearing, and what resources and where they're coming from. We need to remember that, and if the agency mandate is becoming a challenge to us. And the day that they become the hindrance for effective delivery of assistance, we're going into trouble, because some of the donors are going to tell us we cannot work like this. So we don't bring ourselves closer together, whether it's ICRC, IFRC, etc. We're going into trouble, and questions can be asked. So we need to find a common way to do this better and more effective. The last point, because I'm not so strong in legal aspects, I would obviously elegantly stay out of that. On Saturday, my wife instructed me to vacuum clean, which is my favorite occupation on Saturday morning. But fortunately, before I managed to get the gear out, the doorbell was sounding, and there were two ladies standing outside with a leaflet on disaster management. And I was immediately intrigued and said, you know, what is this? And it was about disaster management, but the secret message, it was about the Bible and how the Bible would assist more effective delivery to victims of disasters. So I had to prioritize vacuum cleaning or listening to them, and I took half an hour with them, realizing that the key message was not disaster management, because I had a little bit of experience in that, but the key message was actually the Bible, and how convinced they were about the telling of the Bible and how we could save the world by using that telling. That may be a bit message back to all of you. A few weeks ago, I was with Oliver in Nairobi for an environmental emergency forum. And at the end, I sort of joked a little bit by the tree huggers. Because if the environmental people come too convinced to us and say, you must do this, you're not going to be successful. You cannot command and control the humanitarian community. Many have tried, and even many further have failed. So it has to be understood, we have to sell these messages with a common mindset of how can this approach actually improve your response. It is the same problem that we have with the humanitarian development nexus. We need to sell the messages and how to improve. It's the same as software. We have all gone through the challenge of having Umoja as a new software, and this has not been an improvement by first click, but that's how Microsoft are selling us new software. First click of Windows 365 will be an improvement from the old. So that's what the message has to say. This is why your response will be better in the future. Thank you.
Let me, before we have to go for another round, and I invite you already to think about perhaps one or two other observations on the observations, but I'd like to just deepen one or two elements with which you just now said, which is that there is essentially so much to do, that it is being bound up in these inter-institutional fights and so forth is something that does not really pay up to the commitment which you signed up to, which is to help people in need. And there, I was wondering whether in this discussion of working across the humanitarian and environmental actors, there has been this exercise of really understanding where the real complementarities are, not on a general level, but in place X or situation Y. Because the solutions come from the situational analysis, from where really then one has these multiple, let's say, areas where one can really find solution in a specific setting that can then be scaled up from that level, or that can be sold as really good examples of where this integration of environmental and humanitarian action works in this specific setting. And the other one is your example of the private sector. And how also from a very granular, localized aspect of thinking, it's simply to understand the private sector as part of society. They are not separate from society, and their investment is suffering from some of the humanitarian and environmental consequences. So I think, while, of course, you all represent headquarter leaders, my question to you is, what is in your work at headquarters that can enable the work of your colleagues in specific settings to have a much freer or a life, a professional life, that is much easier to reach out to the other and find solutions. Could you elaborate on perhaps one of the experiences? I see you nodding.
I was nodding for different reasons. Because no, when you said when you said the headquarters person, I was getting a bit worried because I have always been the field person. Okay. So somebody is now addressing me as the headquarters person, so I should start thinking about moving back to the field. So that's why I was nodding. So.
I think you heard from me from the very beginning the emphasis on the work, and I believe on that. Mostly, I have worked at the country level. Most of my 25 years of community work has been in the field, and very few years in Geneva. This time it's only 2 years now. And very important part of the, and in my current position now, very important part of this function has always been that the Geneva office, what I call the back office, this is the office that facilitates what happens. And my message always has been that if somebody is calling me from Sierra Leone, they are not calling me for a speech or another 10 questions, or 10 smart questions to ask. They are calling me from Sierra Leone, meaning that they haven't been able to find a solution. And they're calling Geneva means that they're expecting a solution from the headquarters. And we can define leadership in many, many different ways, and probably if you get 100 books, you might get 101 definition of leadership. For me, the way I see the leadership in the headquarters is you find solutions. The leaders find solutions, the headquarters should offer the solutions. So this is one part. And invariably, a organization like us, the resources at the headquarters are treated reasonably better. You have a country office of 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 people. Headquarters has only 300, 400, 500 people. Invariably, you have that problem. That's one thing. The second thing is setting the tone, and this is something I have found with our new Secretary General a few years in the job now. What a difference it makes when a leader sets a tone on the direction you want to go towards. It does much more than your policy, strategy document of 200 pages of guidelines. So setting the tone, this is how you want to move forward. So that's sort of setting the tone there. The setting the tone also includes setting the tone working in partnerships. I must say, in the last few years, this has become very, very common, and I think that I find much more willingness among the agencies to work together with others. This was not the case until very recently. Even now, I think there is still a bit of my territory, my flag. And frankly, it happens within the Red Cross Certification family also. I'm not saying we are perfect. We have that issue too. But I think we're getting a bit better there. But again, the leadership setting that tool makes a very, very big difference. That we want to go across. The problems are so big that no one organization, no one government, no one company can fix them. There is enough problem. We don't need to fight to get a bigger share of the problem. There is enough to be shared. So I think these are sort of the few things that come on top of my head. Of course, there could be policy, normatic things. We can do many, many things. But setting the tone, I see, is one of the big things. I'm finding solutions.
And you wanted to come into this, but on the enabling role of the headquarters to come to deal with this.
Actually, I entirely agree with everything Jagan has just said. I think, in addition to setting the tone, the headquarters staff leadership can enable the kind of interaction across institutional borders that is very difficult to achieve. I sit in the UN Development Group in New York, and I hear them talking about everything at the country level, and I think I understand the motivation. But I challenge you all to be very honest and fair. Would any of you agree to a situation where the country level representative can change your institution's policies? How could you manage that? If you have representatives in 100 countries, you run the risk of having very divergent set of policies. And institutionally, that's just not fair. So if we are to say that the environmental aspect needs to be brought into the reflections humanitarian assistance and humanitarian action. The first place that has to happen is where policy is made, and policy is made in headquarters. And then the headquarters has to set the tone to make it a part of the way in which the representatives of the field operate. It is expected that they operate in collaboration. And that we at headquarters remove every institutional barrier to that kind of collaboration. If we can do that, then it becomes the way in which we operate. Now, you also mentioned, Jana, that we are more collaborative than we used to be. And I think that's also true. I think in large part it has come because we are being obliged to do so because we are being starved of resources. Yeah? Part of the problem, though, is that we are so fixated on generating from the donors, and I say that deliberately, from the donors the resources we need to do our core functions, that we fail to understand that we can be more effective in what we do as a mandate by working through others. And if others who are better placed to carry out a given type of policy or a given type of intervention, if they get the donor money to do that, they are nonetheless realizing our mandate. We can feed into that outcome, but we can't claim responsibility for it. And that is the other part of the problem. Because for those of us who depend on donor funding, we have to be able to attribute success back to our supporters. Because the donors require it. They want to see those results. And we are being, sorry, Felix, I'm putting it out there a little bluntly, but we are under this imperative to always show how effective and how great we are. Not we as an international community, not we as the environment community, not we as the humanitarian community, but we as OCHA, or we as UN Environment Programme, or we as the International Organization of Migration. And until we can get our funding sources to understand that we are collectively much more effective than we are individually, it's going to be difficult to achieve the full integration of any kind of policy, including the environment into humanitarian.
So here again, I see an opportunity for a strong joint voice across humanitarian and environmental actors back to the donors, because the objective is to achieve the mandate and not to make UNEP look good in one way or the other, if I paraphrase that. Hugo, you want to come in?
I do want to come in. I actually also want to agree with Jagan and the Red Cross Red Crescent Federation view that leadership tone is critical to enabling these things. And then I would just add one other thing, but this may be a particular ICRC obsession, but I don't think it is. In ICRC, everyone is so committed to remaining neutral, being focused on the mission, not in any way sort of contaminating the simplicity and legal basis of their mission, that we also need a very strong, and this is a word that I didn't use at all when I got to the ICRC, a very strong narrative on why. And I think it's a little bit, I think Emilia spoke a bit about this morning in the whole partnership thing. People need to know why this is important. So the leadership tone includes that argument of why. And I think once that connection is made, and certainly in the ICRC, it's felt therefore to be legitimate, mission aligned, and in no way breaching neutrality, then partnerships are the third thing. And we're doing our new institutional strategy at the moment for 2018 to 2022, our four-year strategy. And partnerships will be at the heart of that. And I think that's the only way to do this kind of thing, will be to partner with people. And then our anxiety will always be one of neutrality, and who are we partnering with, etc., and how is it perceived. And that's, to be frank, speaking with UN people here, that's also one of the reasons we might hesitate sometimes with the UN, because in many contexts in which we work, the UN is perceived as positioned, even belligerent, and so we have to be careful. And that's the same with the state itself. You know, we might want to partner with the state on all sorts of things, but in some areas, where we're working in opposition areas or across the line, numbers, we also have to be careful about partnerships. But I would agree in principle that it is tone, argument, or justification, rather, rationale, and then partnerships, because we need them.
Which is an important reminder, in a sense, also to connect what you just said, that of course, from the perspective of headquarters, the primacy and the legitimacy of policy formulation at the headquarters versus some very, very different policy needs or the ability to diverge from that policy line due to the political circumstances in a specific setting, what you just mentioned, because in some areas,
the UN is perceived to be very neutral, and in others, the UN is perceived to be part of a political constellation. And whether you're UNEP or OCHA or another UN agency, people, the religions will not necessarily make the differentiation. So there is that very interesting tension between the need to be able to define policy from the ground up, and of course the headquarters wish to keep it all more or less harmonized. There is no solution except for being a UN official and having this part of your bone marrow. But ladies and gentlemen, we have a little bit more time for observations and questions. The gentleman in the back, oh wow, here we go. I like that. So you did stimulate our audience after hour number two. Yes, I did. Please introduce briefly yourself.
Yeah, my name is Basile Monteiro. I'm a professor at St. John's University in New York. My question is regarding policy. Policy in general is kind of after the fact, it's a responsive policy. That something happens, just happens, you go and respond to that. I was wondering if there could be some kind of rethinking in terms of policy making that would be the equivalent of responsibility to prevent, and thus the institutions that you are representing, you could have a local chapter, so local cultivating, developing, and capacity building at a local level. When such a thing happens, they are almost autonomously able to function. There is enough capacity there on the ground that nothing has to be, as you were saying, your office becomes the back office where you have some kind of solution. Because I find that we don't seem to be developing anticipatory policy, meaning anticipating problems, because these things are going to be very, very common as time passes by. So I think it's time to start thinking that there will be a need to create local chapters, local offices, which would respond right away. But also, scanning the environment, where are the potential problems, and thus doing the prevention work, rather than waiting until it explodes. So would that kind of approach be taken to develop policy that would be what I would categorize as anticipatory policy, rather than simply being a responsive policy? Thank you.
Thank you, and at least we don't need to change the acronym. It's still R2P. Responsibility to prevent. Yeah. On the gentleman on the left, yes, please.
Robert Oakes, United Nations University. We've spoken quite a lot this morning and this afternoon about the need to break down these silos, which I think everyone agrees, and this is why this sort of forum is so important. I agree that there is expertise out there, and one challenge is to bring them together, but I was wondering what your perspective would be on what new knowledge still needs to be generated, because Hugo mentioned the idea about new fuels for jets. Okay, that would be amazing, of course. But what other, doesn't necessarily have to be a massive paradigm shift, but what other new knowledge still needs to be generated?
Thank you very much. Our colleague from Switzerland.
Thank you much. Just a few comments also on the point on fundraising. And I'll say that mentioned it. From my side, I'm more coming out from a donor perspective. I have also said I've never experienced an agency told me, oh, we'd like to share this money with another agency. That has never experienced in my life so far. So, because I think it would be quite open if an agency say, hey, they have more knowledge about this, it would be good to include them. Generally, they are quite open. My experience is rather also say, hey, would we like to put others? But then perhaps that's also another bias perception. And for me, this what I have heard was also said that this fear of failure, that there is no, we can't fail, because if we would fail, there would no new money come in. I can't exclude it, but I'm not fully sure if it's always the case. I think that in particular in multilateral affairs, where if you have a ministry who's interested in the topic, so if you do environment, you're really interested in it. I think there's also a relation, you know each other quite well, and there is space to build trust and work on project and learn together on it. The question also, how can we establish kind of relationship between donors and agencies, for example, what has to change? And then perhaps, I don't know, if the UN system I can also learn, particularly experience from the Red Cross and other stakeholders, who are a bit more flexible to know how to work with donors. And that doesn't mean betray your principles, not at all. But how can I think the UN system, I don't know how, is also not that flexible sometimes with their rules. It's also good because you have corruption rings and so on. But how can you dialogue with donors to create this space that you can trust each other? And then about Alice opening science, like a very important point. I don't have the data, but my feeling is that in the UN system, people rarely change from one agency to the others. Often they stay in the same agency. I think the interest, you can also work with an environmental background to work in UNHCR and so on. I think it could also be something, how can this be improved, that you also take over this, this knowledge. And then you talk about headquarters. Me as Swiss, I have to mention the National Geneva. I think it's also clear that headquarters that a lot are here in Geneva. How can they strengthen this collaboration, like what we do today, is having this exchange, can also be a very important input to strengthen collaboration and open the silos.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ben Schachter from the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights. I want to emphasize, again, something one of the earlier speakers said, which is the importance of prevention. And really starting there. And so things like social protection floors, inclusive and participatory disaster risk reduction and management are really critical to addressing these problems before they become full-blown humanitarian crises. And then I want to challenge two things that I've heard repeated a lot so far today. And one is that the United Nations cannot. Right. But it's not been said, but we've talked about the UN and agencies as having an institutional culture which prevents innovation and doesn't let these actions that need to happen take place. And I think we need to do more to address that institutional culture. And this ties into the second thing I wanted to talk about, which is I've heard a lot of talk about working with businesses and public-private partnerships and their ability to innovate and the resources there. And I agree that there are things we can learn from businesses, but I'm really skeptical and very concerned about this full-fledged embrace of the PPP model and the 2030 agenda. And I don't see any empirical evidence that indicates that businesses are such a big part of the solution, and they're really a huge part of the problem. We know that particularly in a context of a humanitarian crisis where rule of law breaks down, that is a perfect opportunity for businesses to come in and make land grabs and cause problems. So while I do acknowledge there's opportunity to work with businesses, it needs to be done in a context where there's a strict and careful assignation of risk and benefit, and where there is an application of the guiding principles on business and human rights. And I really don't see that is happening in the current sort of headlong rush to embrace the PPP model for development. And so I'm very interested to hear if you have any thoughts on that.
Thank you very much. Very important to recall. And I heard recently say that there is now a new model out there, which is the PPPP model, the public, private, and people partnership, because that people and civil society organizations should be included in this concept.
I'm Amara from UNHCR. Well, actually, if I talk more about coordination, I think everyone appreciates the importance of coordination. But it is very difficult really to be coordinated by the others, be it a mandate or other issues. So if I just further follow up to the question of Greg, which it says, who should be on the table? Ask who should lead. I don't know who should lead to mainstream development into humanitarian action. A typical example currently, I think, in Bangladesh crisis. I know FAO was there a few days ago to do an assessment. And currently, what the food program is doing also a similar assessment. And I think I'm heard now, the Red Cross is also deployed. So this is a fragmented approach where we are not fully coordinated. So my question is, again, who should be such a person if we agree with mainstream balance into a big market?
Thank you very much. There was another hand up in this area, I think, no? Okay, then what I would say is that, because time is running a little bit short, we'll take just each speaker a minute or two to respond to one of these elements which I mentioned, but also to share perhaps one of your reflections of today. No? And so what is your core reflection, but also reflecting again the type of final questions you have heard, some of them are extremely profound, which relate to some of the elements which we already discussed. Selection is always the best. Here you go.
Thank you. I'd like to respond to Ben's concern, the skepticism about the, as you call it, the headlong rush to include the primary sector. It may seem that way to those of us used to doing things in the intergovernment. It requires a real reorientation. But it requires, above all, the recognition that now, in the age of sustainable development and our new agenda, it is quite out of the question that the public sector is going to be able to do this. The private sector is where the jobs are going to come from. The private sector is where the investments are going to come from. The private sector is where the technology is going to come from. It's going to enable us to continue the one planet. Once we recognize that, then we have to see, well, what will be the way in which we interact. You're quite right. We have the principles of business engagement based on the human rights. And we should insist on that. We should refuse to engage with any business entity that does not respect those principles, or where there's the least bit of doubt. But that should not be an indictment against the private sector as a whole. There are some unscrupulous private sector entities. There are a lot of unscrupulous government officials as well. So, I mean, that in and of itself only calls upon us to be a little bit more vigilant, to make sure that we insist on the values of our international system, our global community. But to pretend that the private sector should take a subservient role in all of this, I think, is perhaps dangerous. Because we simply will not succeed without them. That said, we should also take into account that it is perhaps also in the interests of the upstanding private sector to see everybody behave according to the appropriate framework of rules, and to help us all enforce that. So, and I was giving you an example of yesterday. We met in the UNFI, the Finance Initiative, where we had private bankers saying, with your colleague Lene from UNHCR, I was talking about the guidance to business, and they were saying, look, if you tell us that this business over there is not compliant with your rules, we will simply cut off the finance. And they're quite prepared to do that. So we can't assume that the whole private sector is a potential source of problems, but we do have to be insistent upon the framework of our values and ensure that when we collaborate with the private sector, we do so in that context. I think I'll stop there. But my main takeaway was, I think it was Hugo, you said that, humanitarian assistance is not. Because I must say, I came in here today trying to see the distinction between the emergency response and then the long-term humanitarian action, and I think now I understand a little bit better that it's not always easy to try and separate the two. One has to be willing to sort of work along the entire spectrum of engagement.
Thank you. Who wants to follow? You?
I can. Yeah. Thank you for those questions. I found them very good. Like all my professor on prevention, I won't say much, but it's the big word from the UN Secretary General at the moment, anyway, in New York, where you live. I'll just say two things. I think, again, international humanitarian law. I mean, if the environmental movement, if the environment is prioritized within the concern for armed conflict as much as human beings are, I think there's a lot in IHL that can prevent environmental damage and increase respect for the environment. So I think that's one area we can focus on prevention together. The second is on this business of recognizing that humanitarian work is often long. And if I think of a lot of the communities, particularly across the Sahel, rural communities that we work with long term, a lot of that work is preventive. So if we're doing cattle vaccination, it's because we're trying really hard to keep alive crucial assets which are vital to preventing further catastrophe in rural pastoralist or semi-pastoralist communities.
So a lot of longer-term humanitarian work should be preventive because it's about resilience and adaptation as well. So I think if we see humanitarian work in that way, it helps us prevent. Is it Robert from UN University on what we need to know? It's a great question, and of course we should ask ourselves that much more. But and it'd be great if the UN University looks into it all, because you're a very good university. I think, first of all, one thing that would intrigue us, and we don't know the answer. I mean, I noticed on the first slide today that Amelia made the link between environment and conflict and talk about driver. I think we don't know enough about the causal relationship between environmental degradation and armed conflict. I think we know in a sense that in armed conflicts, once they start, natural resources become a source of strategy. You know, you can predate natural resources from your enemy in order to take them away from a position of strength and to increase your strength. So we know once the fight has started that environmental resources play strategically in the dynamics of that fight. But you know, this old thing that, you know, environmental degradation will cause conflict. I certainly haven't been any of the on that. So that would be one area. The second is exactly what the Assistant Secretary General said about forecasting. I know the Red Cross, Red Crescent Climate Center is working really hard on finance-based forecasting. You know, how much can we use better forecasting, weather or multi-hazard, as you were saying, and actually make predictions and apply financing in advance? So in a sense, have a futures strategy of financing that would help us. That knowledge would be good. And then I thought I ought to think of something rather banal. Waste. I mean, we've talked about waste in urban areas. This is something that's really hitting us hard in the ICRC. When we got into Taiz in Yemen, which had been under siege for many, many months, yes, we were shocked and, you know, by the condition of people, but what really shocked people when they got in was the waste, because this was a middle-income, not quite middle-income country, this was a country, you know, using a lot of import commodities, and the waste, the non-biological, non-degradable waste was staggering. So I think any new knowledge about waste management, funnily enough, in urban environments would be really helpful in our work in humanitarian work. The other thing that really helps us most, I think, is, and I'm a bit biased to this, is appreciative inquiry. You know, we have so much research, and it's part of the sort of Western mentality as well, of looking at problems and criticizing everything. We get so much research that tells us problems, and then as an add-on on the last page comes up with some speculative conclusions and recommendations. What really works best for operational agencies is appreciative inquiry when researchers go out to look for what worked. So if you go and look for success stories, that research is much more compelling, much more usable to an operational agency. So I would just urge you, in anything you do with us a lot, to focus on appreciative inquiry in some ways if you can. On business, I actually got a soft spot with Ben's critique. I tend to agree with it. I mean, I tend to totally agree with what Elliot said, that, you know, there's good and bad in business and government and all that stuff. I do think, because I was in business for a bit, that you know, my family's been in business, and so I think the public sector doesn't get business. And the fact that it calls it the private sector always indicates to me that it has no idea about business. Because I've never heard anyone in business say, oh, I work in the private sector. They've never used that term. They say, I work in business, this is what I'm trying to achieve, this is the money I'm trying to make, this is the market I'm trying to break into. Okay, so I think we have to see them as business and realize that in many ways, they, you know, it's business that, not UNDP, that created the wealth in China. It is business that drives wealth, as Elliot said, and drives change. The public sector is terribly small. I remember when I was in business, one of our clients was a sort of medium-sized hedge fund in London. They had a 20 billion portfolio for Africa, for emerging markets, 20 billion sterling, and they weren't considered very big. Now, you know, DFID's budget for global aid is 7 billion. You know, so this is, you know, we're peanuts. And I think once we recognize that, then we see, well, why would they want to play with us, you know, very much? But I do think there's things we can do in armed conflicts. Because if you think about the people we work with, most of them are business people. When we do cash at micro level, we're supporting family businesses and farming, shops, markets, whatever. Those are family businesses, usually, or one-person businesses. I think as we look now in the Middle East, if we look at Ukraine, if we look at many middle-income urban contexts, we've got to step up a gear and understand what it means to do mezzo-finance support for business continuity of the SME sector in context. Because many, you know, we can't reach everybody in urban settings with food or whatever and water. We have to say, you know, who are the bakeries in Tice? Who actually are the 12 big bakeries or the firm that is importing meat and running the abattoir? Who's doing that? Because that's going to drive food security. We have to find models of mezzo financing, which is not, you know, $100 a family or whatever for the small family farmer, but which is more like tens of thousands, millions to maintain business continuity of civilian focus and civilian-centric survival and things like this. And so I see business differently. I share your view that they're not really going to come to the party. They do drive development and change much more than public sector investment. And I think we ought to focus on a different level now that, you know, a lot of armed conflicts are in the middle of the country. My one big thing is just a yes. I mean, this has reminded me, and that's why I'm very glad to be here, that the ICRC's got to do much more about this nexus. We have to make it strategic. And I've already said we have to put it in our institutional strategy for 2018, so I'll try and do that.
Thank you. And thank you for putting him on the business comment. This was excellent. I think Mr. Chan wants to
sign. Yeah, it's just the last round, right? it's a three-piece information for you. I missed this headquarter role here, but I just give a quick comment here. We have a small headquarter here in the around 300 staff, but our Secretary General always educate us that we have like a coin, you have double side, two sides. One, you are secretary, which means you provide service. But another side, you have a word, general. You must take lead. And especially for the most important issues, global issues. And I give two examples, right? Now, every year, WMO collect global events. And we produce the annual climate statement, which is widely received and distributed at every year COP meeting, which give you all the partners a global picture what exactly happened based upon all the facts. And continue to do this for 20 years and give the whole organization a clear picture what are the organizational priority. And certainly we are facing the emerging challenges, and then every 4 years we update our strategic plan, put the new societal needs at a very high level. So that's the key role as a leading of global business. And certainly promote global collaboration is great. Because this organization have a very special, because it's not either you want to collaborate or not. The nature of the business, you force you must collaborate. Otherwise, no single country can predict global weather and the climate. So that's many years to build a kind of collaborative spirit and a culture in our organization, which make us stronger and more, you know, it's a powerful in our business areas. Second point, I would say that about the policy part. As Elliot said, this is the areas that we do believe that have a great room to further improve. We are very good at promote science and technology and also a real operational level of collaboration. However, when we handle the policy part, we do have a, you know, big challenge, because it's a system, political as well, even as regional picture are so diverse. And so the appearance we gain that is that to collect different showcases, and you cannot enforce member to anything. That's their authority. But you provide different cases and they pick the best suit to their system, and they can still use it. You do not find one solution. You must have a much choice which fit to the real society, the real world. So that's for example, we see someone say it's a permission. Yes, we do have this. You know, it's a policy. A good example that building bike better, because otherwise you just repeat the same damage, same economic loss. So we have this, but this is difficult that the meteorological service should engage
more in the city design, and the relevant agency, they are responsible for building the facility back better. We are in the service role, right, in these areas. But also the one challenge from this colleague about this is who take the lead to coordinate. I just my last point that WMO is a service organization. And we know our role that we provide the service. We are WMO is an organization easy to be coordinated. And we have a clear role that, for example, at the national level, when we provide the service to the heresy organization, national heresy organization, this heresy organization, they are taking a leading role. For example, the heat wave, Ding Chung Hao, and that get more and more people dead. So that's the real responsibility, their authority. But they need information. We are the partners. The partnership was very good. We are not clear that we must take a lead. No, that's not the reason. Your role is to take lead for the service. But the other organization take the lead for the action, for the responsibility. Finally, and that my takeaway message is that I showed the case to our UK colleagues about the refugee case. And the conclusion is that a partnership and the advice save lives. So my takeover messenger is that I have a slogan I like it very much. Humanitarian is a permanent topic for the world because we are live with the nature. We are live with the different political decisions, situations. So my word that if we want to go far, go fast, go alone, if you want to go far, go together. WMO is willing to go together with all these partners. Thank you.
What a word. Thank you. Now, let's go briefly now to just keep on the spirit with a final concluding take home. And why don't you start us with your final concluding observation?
No, I think this has been a wonderfully rich discussion and afternoon, and really the questions and the topics posed have been, so rich and important. And I think it shows again, if we can try to come back to where we started off, I think that I'm trying to bring it down again from the macro probably to some quick points. I think what my conclusion or what I will take away is that the importance or the need to establish a common language. We have seen humanitarians and environmental development actors tend to speak different languages. So we need to establish a common language, and this is only possible when we have concrete action areas to focus on. For example, rapid environmental assessment designed for humanitarians, but with the help of environmentalists. We talked about the incorporating the voices from the field, and this is, of course, very important. And related to the previous point, we need to hear what our field colleagues need and can find useful. And then colleagues implementing the humanitarian action need to be included in these dialogues. So again, it has to be, we need to make sure that we have two-way discussion. And at the end, ensure that environmental actors are more actively engaged in the prevention and recovery action. I think these are all things we've discussed, and hopefully if we can at least bring these three things forward. That's my conclusion to this.
Thank you very much. What would be your conclusion for today?
Thank you very much. Yes, so also reflecting a little bit the very good questions that are coming in and some of the replies that has been. So let's face it, especially the humanitarian community, but our environment, but probably also the environmental environment, is driven by buzzwords. I have a whole drawer full of buzzwords that's been sort of the leading discussion topics for many of panel discussions and workshops throughout the years that I've been engaged. And either you embrace them because they fit your mandate, you have a good message, or sometime I even have to admit I dive and then just wait for the next buzzword that fits it better. Because it has really no consequences today. Everybody goes around and talk about the strategic development goals right now. Tomorrow we'll talk about something else, and yesterday we talked about resilience or localization or whatever. So if we want to change this, because these are markers out in the horizon, and then there are some incentives, workshops, donor money that goes with it, etc. A few years ago, we all talked about climate change adaptation. Why? Because we thought there would be some new money in that that we could benefit from. So we will have to come together in a totally different level of accountability, both with the donors and with ourselves, to really be serious in implementing some of these many concepts, because they live very shortly. I can just see in the humanitarian community all the different sort of frameworks that we have been under in the last few years. So here we have to hold ourselves accountable in a different way and really mean what they call prevention. Because we've had that discussion within my organization recently, because we're short of money, that's no secret, and we have to reduce. And we said, okay, be operational, be responsible, we don't prevent. So everybody that deals with prevention should be separated. So that's a way to find where we can do savings. And of course, nobody suddenly deals with prevention anymore. In this actual room here, 10, 12 years ago, I was somebody had fallen sick and somebody has declined. I was in a workshop with IMG, so the Lausanne Business School. This is where people are paying 120,000 Swiss francs for business administration masters. These are coming CEOs. And we had, like today, a very well-prepared facilitator. So we had 60 people from all over Europe in this business school, and it was about corporate social responsibilities. And this is the first time and ever I've been in a panel that collapsed, and the session totally collapsed. Why? Because the presenter that was facilitating it, he asked some questions, and he said, okay, now Nestle, which is a Swiss company that do milk powder and chocolate and other things, he said, okay, Nestle generously gave 50 million Swiss francs to the humanitarian community to distribute milk powder study in Africa. What was the revenue? What did Nestle actually earn on that deal? And that was the question that was open. And then when he revealed accounting information that actually Nestle put 250 million in their pockets because of this side deal. Of course, some of us in the panel got a little bit loud. That was maybe not what we had expected. And the participants supporting the two participants from Nestle got really upset and started getting out of the room. The next question he raised, he asked the question, the only one that would gain from the invasion in Iraq is the American private sector. I will not give you the answer, it's very controversial who actually asked that question. But that led the whole panel to collapse, and that was the end of corporate social responsibility discussion at the IMD, and they've never taken this up again and never come back to that. So yes, I totally agree with the private sector. We have to be careful, and we need to have a clear dialogue on what we need, because we need to express what we need from them, not them telling us what they can do from us. The last point I want to touch about is about your work about coordination. Who should coordinate? I would rather say who should be coordinated. OCHA has a mandate, as a role, as a coordinator, and so have others in their respective mandates, and this is sometimes the challenge. We all have a past. I have a past from the military, and one of the things that the military is doing significantly different from the humanitarian community, apart from killing people instead of saving them, is that they work in a structure where coordination are enabled. We don't have command and control, so coordination only happens when it's enabled. I've seen the name of Hugo. He worked probably 100 meters from my office. We never met, even though we work in the same sector, because there is no place where we meet apart from these discussions. So that's the way part. We are not enabling coordination. We having the strategic level of the principles that are all politically chosen and probably don't really know details what we're doing on the ground. And then we have the coordination on the ground. So it's only on the ground where the different experts that we deploy are getting together and realizing, okay, actually there was another agency that did the same type of assessment as you're doing now, so what is this? What the military is doing differently is that they have, when they have a crisis that they're responding to, they are gathering all the agencies involved in a central location with the expertise, and from there the coordination and the decisions and the directions are made. We don't do that. We have no place to meet. We don't have a coordination center in Geneva, but we are in Bangkok or wherever, where we're dealing with the Rohingya crisis, where we're getting all this together. And instead of World Food Program and UNFPA and IFRC and many, many others are going to do exactly the same regulation, we put it together and identify the experts that best can do it and give us a common operational picture that can bring it together. second last comment, because the last comment is, I would go back to where Eliot started. It's about the expertise. One of the things we are not so good at is modeling. Every time there's a crisis, there's a lot of experts, well, environmental experts, experts in all sorts of things, and they come in and are experts in these things, and they come out with experts' statements, but they are not translated into words that can actually use and understand to plan and respond better. We need to have people who are experts, but also understand the humanitarian community, or the humanitarians that understand the experts, to really benefit from these experts. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think I'm the last one to speak, so I hope the panel will not collapse at the end of this. Maybe I will touch on this your question around the anticipatory policies. I think that's clearly our ambition. I don't know how successful we have been, but you know, when we make the policy, that's clearly our ambition. I think Hugo mentioned the forecast-based financing. That's one of the areas actually we practiced that in Bangladesh this year with extremely good results. That, you know, forecasting the disaster and actually making resources available actually resulted in only 140 dead from this current disaster, where 16,000 people have died in the past with a similar risk of disaster in the same area. So we have, and we did a similar thing with these hurricanes in the Caribbean now, but each of the countries that were supposed to be affected by hurricanes, we actually made the resourcing decision before these countries were here. This is of course not possible for every disaster, you know, earthquake, you don't know, but some of these disasters we could. So clearly there is a commitment on what you said. How successful we are, I don't know. But fully agree with the direction you are saying. The one of the other things we have been investing in last couple of years within the Red Cross, Red Crescent families, what we call a Solferino Academy, which is in Solferino, that's when the Red Cross was created. That's from where the idea of the Red Cross came. The whole discussion around futures thinking, you know, the leaders and the staff and the volunteers coming together and really discussing and thinking and modeling what the futures could look like and how we as a Red Crescent family should position ourselves, our policies and our strategy. It's a very interesting investment. It's less than 2 years old, so let's see how it develops, but that's clearly an area where we are very interested. And we are investing on that moving forward. Let me not say much around the private sector. We clearly have a very diverse views here. I'm the last speaker, so I can say things because the panel is sort of not collapsing. I mean, my belief is, and I think I sort of a little bit subscribe to what you said, Elliot, is we cannot ignore the private sector. We may like it, we may not like it, but we cannot ignore. Are there good apples and bad apples? Yes. But are there good apples and bad apples in humanitarians? Are there good apples and bad apples in government? My own experience has been both. It's been mixed. I have been involved. I used to be the regional director for Asia Pacific before. I have engaged with some of the private sector networks in Philippines, the disaster reconstruction network, in Indonesia, in Vietnam. Sometimes better work than a lot of humanitarians are doing. So we have an example. Are we able to have a principal partnership with them? I don't think the humanitarian sector is that weak that we cannot develop a principal partnership. That's my belief. We are not that weak. Huh? So we cannot ignore it. Now the takeaway, I think it will be a bit of a, I was sort of going to say that, you know, what Elliot said, that can we move to a situation where we are comfortable and happy when our mandate is delivered, even if it is delivered by someone else. But then when NGM said that, you know, you want to move fast, work alone, and you want to move far, work together, I think for me that's the gist of the discussion today. We need to move fast, it's a long game, and if we want to play that long game, we have to work together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What a group of discussion today. We have now discussed for 2 hours. And the only thing, as your moderator, the only two things I'm still going to do is to do one advertising bit and give Elliot the word for final remarks to conclude. The one advertising bit that there is more possibilities. to discuss across institutions and sectors at this year's Geneva Peace Week from the 6th to the 10th of November. Be there, be square. That's where you have to be if you want to know about prevention across institutions and sectors, because this is exactly what the focus team is going to be. We have various individuals from New York coming, partly because there's so much emphasis on filling the Secretary General's report on prevention with new ideas. And this is why I would encourage the ENG to write up a very good report of this meeting, because there seem to be open ears in New York at 38th floor, of wanting to find out what are some of the thinking from the humanitarian and environmental community. And with these words, I would like to thank you for being a great group, for not falling apart. So there is some sense of progress after 12 years. And Elliot, to give you the floor for some closing remarks. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Hakim. Let me echo the thanks to the panel. I think we had a really stimulating discussion. Again, I will go away having learned something that I didn't know 2 hours ago. There were certain themes I thought that came out in the discussion, and I think there's a certain amount of agreement around them. And I'm not going to go into a detailed description of them. Just to highlight, we talked about leadership of the institutions, of the actors, and the role of leadership in setting the tone, setting the narrative, and enabling the collaboration. We talked about prevention. I think all of us agree that prevention is always better than cure, and that we are in the long haul. This is not something that is a short-term endeavor. It may be a series of short-term motivations, but the actual engagement is a longer term engagement. We have to use that as the bridge, if you will, to bring the environment into the humanitarian, to bring the humanitarian into the environment, and to link it all up with decent security and development. So, in many respects, I think we are already headed out in that direction, and so that should be a reassurance to the 30th for our mission. I also think that we have left a couple of issues on the table for the one of them is the question of the funding. You know, we had different opinions, differences of experience on the funding question, but it remains a problem. There still is this dichotomy between the funding for the humanitarians and the funding for the developmentalists, and there seems to be a seesaw between the two, at least the perception of the seesaw. When the humanitarians have enough money, the developmentalists don't. If that is true, then there is a fundamental issue. We do need to think a little bit about how and the last thing I want to say is that we all, I think, have underscored that it is not just about the official humanitarian community. We will be successful over the longer term when we engage with all who have expertise and a contribution to make. And in particular, when we find ways to engage with the local communities, the local actors, the ones who have the most knowledge of the ground and also benefit from our activities. And so I think, again, thank you all for having taken the time. Many of you have been here since 9 o'clock this morning. I think it was a rich discussion this morning, an even richer discussion this afternoon, and we have learned a lot, and we recognize that in some of the areas where we need to do a little bit more. Thank you all. Thanks again.
Thank you very much, Hakim, and distinguished panelists and participants for this very substantive discussion. You might have found the answers to some of your queries in the morning. I still have some more questions. I hope that in the future, in the additional panel discussion on other dimensions of the humanitarian and environment next steps, we will be able to tap into those dimensions from the prevention, from management, and also the post-conflict, and also sustainable development aspects of the humanitarian agenda. We can be able to bring other colleagues around the table. A few additional and supplementary information about our Nexus dialogues and the Nexus steps. As we close this Nexus dialogue, we would like to keep this community connected still. Even if we have finished this, we would still like to be in connection with you, because we are going to set up, hopefully, a new interagency process in the ENG, working on the issues and the dimensions of this topic that was brought to our attention for further action in the future. So we would like you to be connected with us. So please stay tuned with us. On on this topic. There will be a summary of the deliberations of today. We try to observe this Chatham House rule, not to be pinpointing to any particular organization, certainly. But we would like to bring some of the key conclusions that would be beneficial to all of us in other forums, in other discussions, so that we can build on them in the future. All the presentations that were made in the morning have already been uploaded in our website. So in case you have not been here at our, you're still interested to look into to those presentations, you're most welcome to do so. In particular, the mapping tool that has been designed and has been actually put online, it is not going to be a one-off product. Actually, we would like the app to be more completed. And then it will be made available to one of the main key organizations, such as, for example, joint unit with the OCHA, or other units that would like to benefit from that in terms of accessing to the common data, common resources, and partnerships in this particular nexus. So we would like to still request your contribution to that mapping and your reference to that online mapping tool, which is available on our website. The last point, but not the least one, of course, is that this nexus series will be completed in December, early end of November, early December, date to be finalized in Nairobi with a final Nexus dialogue on pollution, cities and health. Those of you who are interested, please inform us. We will be communicating the invitation, of course, to you by email. And it will be held in Nairobi in the margins of the UN Environment Assembly. And then we would really much invite your proposals for the next year Nexus dialogue topics. It has to be based on a needs sort of approach. So we do not want just to guess and anticipate. We would like to build it on your needs, on your issues that you feel a collaboration or a dialogue would be useful. So please be forthcoming and propose your topics for the next dialogues. Again, thank you very much to all of you. Again, warm thanks to Switzerland, to all of the panelists for coming here. And look forward to continue, and also to the colleagues who are behind the scene. We have actually a group from the University the whole discussion. So you're all on the website. If you have said something wrong, you will be asked by your parents or by your children at school. So be careful about that. We have also the secretariat colleagues. Who have really helped us in the logistics and the preparations, that Yannicka, Irene, and Garan, and Amanda, and the rest that I have not referred to. So thank you to all of you very much, and look forward to our continued